What surface antigen is present in people that have type O blood group? A antigen, B antigen, A and B antigen, A or B or no antigen? Sickle cell hemoglobin HBS has two alpha and beta chains with sickle cell variant. What point of mutation occurs in these individuals at 0.6 of the beta chain? A, B, C, D, and E. Next. A 47-year-old woman is found to have macrocytosis. Upon further investigation, a folate deficiency is diagnosed. The macrocytosis is the result of impaired synthesis of which compound? Anca positive polycythemia glomerulonephritis is seen in which condition among these options? Which of the following is false regarding Philadelphia chromosome? Aurochs are found in post-splenectomy, peripheral blood picture does not contain. Leukocyte alkaline phosphatase score is diminished in which condition? Virchow's node receives lymphatics from all except. Reed-Steinberg cells is found in all except. Basophilia is classically found in. Chloroma is found in which hematological condition? Increased iron and normal TIBC is found in which are found in Pellgar-Huet anomaly is which of the following is not true in thrombocythemia? Warm antibody mediated hemolysis is not found in spur cell anemia is seen in which of the following is not seen in HUS? Circulating anticoagulants are found in palpable purpura is seen in increased serum iron and decreased TIBC is a feature of macrocytic hypochromic anemia is found in Hess capillary fragility test is positive in which condition? Parahemophilia is a deficiency of factor. And the last question, Geisbock syndrome is associated with Thank you.
Okay, all can return your answer sheets now.
For the cases are little more into the orientation of pure hematology, so audience may not answer, so I need panel members to answer the questions. First two cases will be discussion on anemia, and next two cases will be on platelet related, and the fifth one will be on lymph node related. A female, she's a housewife, and husband was working as a waiter in a canteen of Kaiga factory, and her only son, who was also working in the same died in an accident. She presented with mainly, basically they are from a poor background, where they just work in a canteen in Kaiga industry. Came with a weakness, dyspnea and exertion, which was new onset, and like decreased exercise tolerance, around 2 months of complaint. That was in January 2018. And there was no history suggestive of any blood loss, menorrhagia, or any bleeding. And there was no history of any malignancy symptoms, like B symptoms, fever, or weight loss, or loss of appetite. The past history, she was an antihypertensive. On examination, she had a pallor. There was mild icterus and splenomegaly, mild to moderate, I can say. The lab values which are available when they went for first presentation was in hemoglobin 6. WBC and platelets were in range, but on the lower side of the normal range. The WBC was around 3,800 and platelet count was around 1,10,000. In Carver, it was treated with iron supplements for 1 month and found no improvement. She also received blood transfusion in the district hospital, which showed a transient improvement and worsened in a month. But there was a drastic worsening. There was a response, but which immediately worsened. And in view of financial constraints, so it was not properly evaluated. 4 or 5 months were passed before they went for a further evaluation. With this background, when the patient presents, what investigation will be asked further? Only one was available was a CBC, and she has received iron, she has received blood. Yeah, peripheral smear, I agree, first one. With retic, yeah. LFT.
Before you go into the investigations, what would be the differential diagnosis you want to keep? Based on that, you develop your next investigations. So what would be the differential diagnosis that you would keep in this lady now?
B12 deficiency. Going for 6 months.
Then? Hemolytic anemia.
Possible.
Okay. Then, anything else?
In view of splenomegaly, do consider, but like it comes in the later part.
Yeah. HLH.
6 months history.
6 months history, no? What sort of myel... What sort of myeloproliferative disorder you would look into? MDS is not myeloproliferative disease. Of the myeloproliferative diseases that we know of, Somebody told me. Yes, myelofibrosis. Okay. Essential thrombocytosis, polycythemia, you will have hemoglobin platelet jumping up. CML, usually you will have the WBC jumping up. You won't have leukopenia, thrombocytopenia there. So when the other cell lines has to go down, you have to think of a myelofibrosis as a possible thing. But with this such a mild splenomegaly, you won't keep that as an upfront diagnosis. Myelofibrosis will not progress so fast as such. They will come little later in this one. Somebody else told, what is that? MDS. What is myelodysplastic syndrome? It's a pre-malignant condition. It's not a myeloproliferative disease. It is rather a bone marrow failure syndrome. Okay, it can be there. Okay, so with that kind of differential that you have, so what is the next set of investigations?
One clue we can get from here is she received blood transfusion. It showed respond, but immediately it worsened. So somebody said hemolytic, which we need to keep in your mind.
Absolutely.
But since the WBC and platelets were normal but on the lower side, so peripheral smear definitely will help us to further narrow down our differential diagnosis.
Yes, fair enough. PNH is something you have to always keep in mind at the age of 50. So you have asked for a peripheral smear, okay, fine. Then retic. No.
Yeah, that's exactly.
That's why I'm coming there. You know, you have jumped to peripheral smear straight away. So you want to see MCV, MCH, you know, what is happening to the RBC size
indices,
basically.
Yeah.
You know, you have the values?
Yes, sir. But I have a post-transfusion values, but transfusion was done 3 months back. So
go back. That's not. Okay, there are too many things there. Okay. So you have asked for a CBC, peripheral smear, retic. Upfront, you want to ask something else? Yes,
LDH. Very good.
So what it will tell? Extent of hemolysis. Okay. And somebody told? What you look for? Bilirubin levels. Basically, you want to look at bilirubin levels to see whether there is indirect hyperbilirubinemia. Then somebody else told? Coombs test. These are the few basic tests that you can upfront ask as soon as the patient comes. It need not be you ask for a CBC. After the report comes, then you know you go and send for ALFT. After that, you go and send for another investigation. Upfront, there are 4 or 5 investigations. These are the things that you can ask. Okay.
So whatever investigation was done on day one, when she presented to me, it was a macrocytic anemia. MCU was 110 with hemoglobin of 6.1. And WBC count was 3,500 with fairly maintained differential count. And platelet count was 1,10,000. The peripheral smear was showing anosmocytosis with macrocytosis. There were few hypolobility and neutrophils, but there were no blasts. LFT was showing mild indirect hyperbilirubinemia. For the given hemoglobin, the bilirubin which was not fitting into exactly hemolytic picture. And liver enzymes and globulins were normal. Coombs was 2+, and ANA was also asked at the same time, which was 2+. Since it was a post-transfusion, actually we should not ask ferritin, B12 and folate. It was already 4 month post-transfusion, that's why we did. And LDH is showing picture of mild hemolysis, and there was no any renal issues. So we can narrow down our differential diagnosis.
Can we make a definitive diagnosis here? Okay. Any other diagnosis you want to keep? Vitamin B12 deficiency. Yeah. They are normal. But then B12 folate levels are normal. Yeah, it is little difficult to say whether, you know, there was truly deficiency of B12 or folic acid. But generally, when you have this kind of Coombs positivity and ANA positivity coming together, then, you know, kind of goes against a megaloblastic anemia. But coexisting megaloblastic or the B12 deficiency cannot be ruled out.
There is no clinical history suggestive of autoimmune disease.
Now, why this ferritin is 980?
This is some sort of iron overload.
Inflammation can give rise to this one. It is not transfusion related, remember. 2 units of packed cells will not jump the ferritin to 900. You know, it takes at least 5-6 units of transfusion before the ferritin starts jumping.
At the age of 55 to 60, we do get, but the percentage of the hypoalbuminemia neutrophil on the smear is important. If it's more than 10%, it becomes a significant.
So now you want, at this stage, you want some more investigations or you are happy with your immune hemolytic anemia diagnosis?
Already they are, like, with this much investigation, they already financially gone down.
Yeah. That much we can tell.
But clinically,
so can we
clinically, there's no feature suggestive of anything autoimmune, like neither the arthralgia nor the skin rash. I mean, the elderly lady, to think of autoimmune.
At 50 years, somebody who is suddenly coming to you with SLE is not very common. So
something is.
Is there something else that you need to think of? Because
Lymphoproliferative disorder can
That's
present as...
That's what Dr. Govindariat was telling in the morning. You know, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, especially somebody at this age, 50% of them can have underlying malignancy, which can give rise to this kind of picture. You know, ANA can be positive as a paraneoplastic positivity. It may not be a primary SLE-related ANA positivity as such. So we cannot start treatment right now, right? Is treatment emergency here now? Patient is not so much symptomatic, so we don't have to jump and start the treatment. So we can evaluate. Anything is there further?
Yes, sir. I mean, what next investigation?
So
differentials we narrow down to, one is autoimmune, other one is underlying lymphoproliferative. Still, the malignancy needs to be reloaded. Other hematological malignancy needs to be kept in the mind. No B symptoms in the history, no B symptoms, no clinically palpable lymph nodes except splenomegaly. Bone marrow, that will be the cost effective one. ₹500 you do and you see, we are able to get to see on the same day, you can come down on the same day.
Correct.
Bone marrow, yeah. I did bone marrow, we'll discuss further. So, with this context, the mild leukopenia and mild thrombocytopenia is a concern which we need to keep in our mind. Along with the anemia, there's a mild cytopenia. Whether diagnosis of autoimmune hemolytic anemia can be made, just Dr. Prasan sir said that still we need to keep that not as a first diagnosis. Autoimmune workup, whether to be asked, with a background of financial constraint, whether bone marrow aspiration and biopsy, the same day which we get answer, we can see on the same day. Lymphoproliferative disorder to be ruled out, as you said, some scan has to be done to look for the lymph nodes which we clinically can't pick up, mediastinal or abdominal lymph nodes.
I think the reason to ask for a bone marrow biopsy here would be because if you want to give a trial of steroids, then you don't want to obliterate any traces of lymphoproliferative disorder in this patient. So that is why you would end up doing a bone marrow earlier than later.
So bone marrow is best tool. Like, we can take a decision. We can rule out a majority of hematological malignancies. And we can think in the angle of the treatment. So when I did and saw myself, I did not find any malignancy. It was hypercellular marrow with erythroid hyperplasia, but there was a mild dyserythropoiesis. It's a mild one. And there was no abnormality in myeloid series or megakaryoid series. Blast count was 4%. It's like anything below 5%, we take it as normal one. Normally, we can have a 5% blast in the marrow. So with this, what will be our differentials which we are discussing? If there's a CLL, would have picked up on the bone marrow. Lymphoma on the aspirate, difficult, we have to wait for the biopsy. Hyperplasia, yeah. We can have mild dyserythropoiesis for the age and for the destruction. Sir, anything you want to add on?
As such, bone marrow aspiration doesn't show any at least at this stage, no hematological dyscrasias. No malignancies are seen at least at this point of time. Biopsy report is there?
Yes, sir. Later on, after 4-5 days, the biopsy report came.
I think there is some dyserythropoiesis. What percentage was that?
It was around 10 to 12%, I can say.
So that is more than 10%, yeah, yeah, with 4% blast.
Blast, yeah.
So, I mean, yeah.
So aspirate is a vital sample, so something we need to do because, I mean, we can't do aspirate again and again. Yeah. So that was a question which I was supposed to.
Yeah, this is something, you know, you should remember. You may be thinking that, you know, I am just doing a bone marrow for a simple reason of making a diagnosis of ITP or autoimmune hemolytic anemia. But remember this, karyotyping. You know, karyotyping is one investigation can be best done in a bone marrow aspirate. So anybody above 50 years, if you are doing a bone marrow, as well take a sample for karyotyping and send it. You know, you will find surprises.
Yeah.
Always.
I mean, I saw the aspirate. Somehow I did not accept the diagnosis of autoimmune. So I mean, aspirate was there in my hand, but I was not able to send karyotyping. There was a financial issues.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah.
I would also probably totally agree with Prashant on that side, because I think we get a lot of referrals where a diagnosis has been made, but then to prognosticate, we don't have the karyotyping, and doing another bone marrow is not a practical or feasible aspect. So any, I agree the cutoff 40, 50 years, it's better to do a karyotyping.
So she walked in the morning. By evening, I was able to arrive at some diagnosis by seeing the bone marrow. Chalo, malignancy is ruled out, but still, as somebody said, MDS needs to be kept in the mind. That was there. But like patient said that like we need to start treatment. She had mild symptoms related to anemia, but at that time their treatment was important for them. But their main concern was mera platelet aur niche chale gaye to, main bleeding ho gaye to. That was their concern. So we started a steroid. We gave a course of a steroid and followed by azathioprine. She improved for 4 months. She did well. The cytopenia resolved. Anemia resolved. For a period of 2 to 3 months, she was all right. And patient took that treatment for 1 year and last for follow-up. After which, in August 2019, she stopped. Again, she presented in December 2019, that is recently. So in my 1 year of practice in Goa, so same patient I saw twice. Presented with similar complaints, found to have a severe anemia. Again, like at the local hospital, received the blood, no improvement, and then she walked in. Same findings. This time there's no icterus. The splenomegaly and pallor, and no palpable lymph nodes. The peripheral smear this time showed 3% atypical cells. And LDH is little on the higher side. LFT is fine, RFT is fine. So at this time, our differential will be? Yeah, definitely. Whether you ask, since lymphoproliferative disorder was there in our mind, whether to, I mean, among these three, which one, the first which you select will be ideally, yes, I agree, bone marrow. Bone marrow is showing significant dyserythropoiesis. There was a myeloid arrest, there is a dysmegakaryosis. At that time it was only dyserythropoiesis, now there is a myeloid arrest and dysmegakaryopoiesis. And the blast were around 6%. And in the biopsy, there was a few areas of foci of an atypical large cells. Probably they were collections of blast.
So what is this now? Lymphoproliferative? MDS.
MDS in excess blast.
We are looking at a myelodysplastic syndrome. What is the classification? MDS.
Single lineage, multi lineage.
RA. EBA. Refractory anemia with the excess blast, stage 1, because the blasts are 6% now. You remember MDS can present with paraneoplastic autoimmunomyelitic anemia. DCT can be positive there, and you give a course of steroids, they will improve. But later the MDS will really come into picture. It is well known entity as such. That's what has happened. If you know finances were good, and if you would have done a cytogenetics upfront, it would have showed us something positive, you know, to tell that from day one, okay, it was MDS.
Again, the DCT could have been positive because the patient received a transfusion also, isn't it?
Positive, so yes, positive. Then I went and did a literature search. Some MDS early, they present with the autoimmune-like features. When you treat the autoimmune component, the obvious MDS comes out. Then I realized that, I mean, my case was matching with the literature. The second time when there was a bone marrow aspirate in my hand, I did a karyotyping. Luckily at that time the Kaiga Institute covered our treatment in Manipal, Goa, so we were able to do. I did a NGS also, I did a karyotyping also. NGS was showing IDH and TET mutation, and karyotype was showing complex abnormalities. There was a trisomy, there was a loss of chromosomes also.
As soon as the transplant unit is ready, put her in. This is a high risk case. Yeah. So actually, one of the faculty members from Yenepoya, several years back, exactly had the same presentation. The faculty came to me with this kind of anemia, mild pancytopenia. Initially, Coombs was positive. You know, it was little steroid responsive. Upfront marrow could not be done because the faculty did not want a bone marrow. But after 6 months, there was a deterioration. I did the bone marrow. It was excess blasts at that time. So I still remember it's exactly same presentation.
Yeah, the message will be try to see the bone marrow on the same day and add on the sample on the karyotyping, because the sample is important, because within 24 hours we need to process for a karyotyping.
Most important is, you know, here at least, you know, for those who are working in Yenepoya and Kshema, the cytogenetics is done in Kshema. They do it for around 2000 rupees or 2200 rupees, which is not a big money. So when you are doing a bone marrow for anybody above 40-45 years, just take a sample and send for cytogenetics immediately, because you need to process that cytogenetic sample within 24 hours. So you can't, you know, tell that I have stored it in the fridge and, you know, after 48 hours pathologist tells possible MDS, then you send this for karyotyping. As soon as you collect the sample, you send it for karyotyping. You will be getting some surprises, you will be getting good diagnosis with that.
Yeah. During my DNB training, they post us in Vellore for this thing. I specially asked for a 6 month extension to do in lab, because I wanted to see myself peripheral smear and bone marrow, so that, you know, be little satisfied that like chalo usidin you can take decision, can further proceed. So those who are interested in MAT should look into angle of lab also. Yeah, I mean, supposed to discuss low risk MDS with isolated anemia. Rajesh sir.
Well, essentially, you decide on the IPSS score or the newer score to decide what is the risk of the patient. Then it again depends on the affordability of the patient also in India. So younger patient with a high risk myelodysplasia, you would consider referral for a transplant sooner than later. But those with low risk, just isolated anemia, initially you could consider a period of supportive care with transfusions or erythropoietin. So if it's just a refractory anemia, then you could consider erythropoietin. That's a category with you know, or what's called the ring sideroblasts. There you could add erythropoietin as well. So that's how I would look into it. So low risk, either observe or give transfusions plus or minus EPO plus GCSF. Then those with low blast counts, you could consider hypomethylating agents also, such as decitabine and azacitidine. But again, those at high risk of progression. One has to remember that in myelodysplasia, you know, these patients can progress into acute leukemia. So that's how, you know, they risk categorize early, decide on the treatment, decide what you can do and whether you can refer.
Sir, whether you can comment on?
Isolated anemia. There are some people. That's what always you can, you know, these kind of patients, when they come, you can give a trial of steroids to see whether they improve. You know, give just 1 week course of prednisolone. If the hemoglobin starts improving, then you can keep on low-dose steroids. That's one thing. Especially if the paraneoplastic hemolysis is there, they will stabilize. Other than that, erythropoietin supplements and danazol is a good drug in these patients. You know, quite few of them respond very well to danazol, and you know, you can take them transfusion free at least. Otherwise, transfusion, remember, after 10 units after 10 to 15 units of transfusions, then we have to start chelating them also. Just like thalassemia, MDS patients are the ones where chelation is required for a lot of them, because after multiple transfusions, they will go into secondary hemosiderosis.
MDS with isolated deletion 5q.
If it is MDS with isolated 5q deletion, then there is enough data to suggest lenalidomide is going to work. At least 60% of the people with isolated 5q deletion. When you talk about 5q deletion, you know, you should not have any other chromosomal abnormality. These are the people who will benefit from lenalidomide, and you can take them for at least quite a few years before they progress, just on the cover of lenalidomide.
The interesting thing about this 5q minus deletion is they present often with thrombocytosis rather than thrombocytopenia. So that's one clue to that. And of course, lenalidomide is quite a good drug, and it's available at quite reasonable prices in India as well. So it is something I think a lot of people can afford. So quite a good treatment for, and yes, it is true that it's isolated 5q minus. I don't know what is the percentage of that deletion in India.
We see quite a few. I have at least 4 patients of 5q deletion now, as of now. So far in the last 8 years, I have seen 4 patients. Quite a few we get. It's not like totally uncommon, especially elderly ladies. We get this chance of isolated 5q deletion syndromes.
I think you may remember lenalidomide because it's a treatment for myeloma. So that is here paradoxically used for myelodysplasia. So do you give it 3 weeks on, 1 week off, or how do you manage? Sorry, that's probably beyond.
Yeah. 3 weeks, 1 week.
No, I give it continuously, but I use low-dose lenalidomide. But what we have found is, you know, with our practice, lenalidomide is useful in almost every condition in hematology. You know, yeah, we use it left, right, center. Because it's so cheap in India.
Immunological weapon.
Yeah, in relapsed lymphomas, relapsed leukemias, we use as an add-on therapy lenalidomide for everybody.
Now the study has come with elderly DLBCL, keep on a len maintenance to prevent the relapse.
True.
Yeah. Going on to second case. Little interesting. Presented with a gait abnormality, anemia patient with a gait abnormality. 50-year male alcoholic, is a manual labor by occupation. Presented with gradually progressive gait imbalance for the 3 years, and he also reported paresthesia in fingers and toes, and subsequently was diagnosed with a idiopathic neuropathy, which become gradually slow progression, but it's worsening. They did a NCV in a government medical college, so found to have an axonal and demyelinating features, sort of a polyneuropathy-like thing. Since he was an alcoholic, they thought probably alcohol-related, and he had a vague back pain for 8 months. Except a mild anemia, rest of the investigations were fine, creatinine was fine, the globins were not elevated, so nobody thought in the angle of the back pain. Everybody thought that the gait abnormality caused a mechanical issue, mechanical back pain, and they started him treated for a polyneuropathy of like an idiopathic feature. They gave a steroid for him and showed an improvement in a gait, and back pain symptoms also improved. After 3 months, it was a short course of a steroid, stopped, and after 3 months of stopping the steroid, he presented with a dyspnea and exertion. This time the anemia symptoms were more, and worsening of a back pain with a restricted mobility. When they took him into ER, the X-ray spine showed a compression fracture of the L3 vertebra. So what will be differential at this time? Pathological fracture, yeah. Differentials. myeloma, Waldenström macroglobulinemia. What was the explanation for the, yes sir.
I mean, you could have thought of subacute, but given a compression fracture,
possible.
I think thinking of, pathological fracture would be reasonable. And again, people were talking about myeloma, Waldenström, all these things are quite reasonable. One has to remember that sometimes in lymphoma also, you can have pathological fracture. So it can be either myeloma or lymphoma, or it can be metastasis as well. So you got a wide differential there. So it's not just one. So you will have to think of a lot of differentials. Now with the peripheral neuropathy type picture, sometimes how I would think about it is, whether with myeloma, do they have amyloidosis, that sort of a situation. Or can it be a paraneoplastic because of another malignancy? So basically, we will need further investigations here to get to know what is causing it. But I agree that it smells like a malignancy and looks like a malignancy.
Yeah.
So we need to know what it is further.
CBC hemogram and LFT were like 4-5 months back it was done. So suppose we need to repeat that and see.
He told initially globulins were normal.
Normal.
So that time there was no myeloma, now it is myeloma? Or there is something else that was missing that time, which they didn't think of? Paraneoplastic syndrome with the peripheral neuropathy is one. Paraneoplastic CIDP is well known. Primary unknown, absolutely. What sir told us, absolutely right. One is CID, paraneoplastic CIDP, primary maybe, it may not be hematological malignancy, it may be solid tumor also. Anything with a primary unknown, that is one. Other one, yes, it can be a light chain myeloma, where globulins may be normal, so you have not picked it up.
Non-secretory myeloma.
Upfront, yes, sir. A-beta lipoproteinemia is one differential diagnosis upfront when he presented on day one. But after this this fracture, then that goes out of question. That's what. So it is very unlikely that it's a Waldenström. Waldenström doesn't have skeletal abnormalities. It is more of osteolytic lesions. So CA prostate, CA breast, gastric malignancy, then you have the myeloma, which are coming as, and lymphomas. Remember, it may not be Waldenström, but isolated bone lymphomas are described in this kind of settings.
Probably it would have lytic, would have not missed, and directly when it was a fracture, we have picked it up. But this presentation was a gait abnormality, which we need to keep in our mind, which was a 3 years complaint.
That is the neuropathy attacks
gait will be there. Yes. We do get in myeloma neuropathy, we do get in LPL neuropathy also, so this. After this, when we saw a peripheral smear, which gives us a clue, peripheral smear showed a rolu formation with a lymphoplasmacytoid cells, and biochemistry showed hypercalcemia, renal failure. This time the globulins were elevated. Probably the last value, I'm not sure. It was not done in my institute, so even though LFT was looking normal, whether it's a lab error or at that time the chains were not elevated, and this time it is elevated, that I'm not sure. Anyway, this time it is hypercalcemia, renal failure, anemia with a high elevated globulin. So multiple myeloma is the Waldenström. Agree. Yeah. But on the peripheral smear, difficult to comment. It can come even in myeloma also. Yes. So when we did a bone marrow, well, yeah, further evaluation will be
bone marrow straight away.
Bone marrow showed around 70% plasma cells. Biopsy showed seeds of a plasma cell. So with this, as we discuss, the diagnosis will be multiple myeloma. But for the as we discussed the differentials of a neuropathy in a hematological conditions, which we need to keep amyloidosis and lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma.
It might have been picked up much earlier in Mangalore, I suspect, because in Mangalore every neuropathy patient will have an electrophoresis free lead chain assay done. Every patient. So that is why we pick up neuropathy myelomas much earlier than any other part of India, I think.
It was in Goa Medical College, and then they came to me.
That's what. It depends on the treating neurologist's perspective, you know. Our Mangalore, I think probably everybody have seen at least one case of myeloma with neuropathy. So every neuropathy patient will have one electrophoresis free lead chain assay done as such here. But there, it might have not been done.
So did you ask for a Congo red also?
Yes, sir. That was a point, yeah. Probably it's a myeloma with amyloidosis. The Congo red on the biopsy was showing apple green bifacient findings. And it on the immunofixation, it was mainly lambda. So when it comes as a lambda, we need to keep amyloidosis in our mind. And there is an entity called as monoclonal gammopathy of neurological significance, which can evolve into myeloma. So presence or any comment on that?
Monoclonal gammopathy of neurological significance. Neurological significance. That I have yet to come across, in the sense that I have not yet read it. Rajesh, sir.
I mean, the monoclonal gammopathy of renal significance is quite extensively studied.
Yes,
but neurological significance, I am yet to listen to a talk about that.
No, just I.
Remember this is because all these terminologies are coming up because these paraproteins, we think that they are less than 3 grams in actual quantity, and there is no myeloma in the bone marrow. There is no disease activity except for small clone. We don't know from where it is coming. And the earlier notion was generally we don't have to do it. But then now we know that they are also troublemakers. They can go and isolatedly trouble the kidney. They can go and trouble the nerves. They can go and trouble the liver. They can go and create trouble. So that time, we need to start the patient on treatment. But how are we going, when there is no myeloma, how are we justified in going and giving myeloma therapy for these patients? That's how these terminologies have come up. That, you know, MGRF is monoclonal gammopathy of renal significance. You have a MGUS or a small M band there, which is damaging the kidney alone. There is no other disease activity anywhere. So you have to then, you know, give the therapy. Yes, sir.
Evaluation, she had multiple myeloma. That lady had progressive vision loss and was advised a corneal transplant. But once her myeloma workup was done, she was treated for that. There was a visual
recovery. So metabolic keratopathy presenting as blindness can be one of the rare manifestations of multiple myeloma.
The high globulins in the serum can manifest as any hyperviscosity in the veins. Basically, end vascular structures can suffer with a high globulin viscosity related.
Yes. I remember once she was given first, this was during my post-graduation, she was given the first chemotherapy and her vision sailed. She was delighted that I'm able to see again. So metabolic keratopathy because of multiple myeloma can be one of them.
So you have a condition called acquired bone Willebrand's due to double imbalance from microglobulinemia. There are also treatment of the underlying lymphoproliferative disease corrects the paraneoplastic complications. So again, one thing to remember is if it's an MGUS, conventionally we don't treat MGUS.
We don't treat MGUS.
We don't treat MGUS.
But do they need follow-up MS people?
Yeah. There is a clear-cut guidance about MS follow-up. You know,
some percentage of people, they go for multiple myeloma. That is what it is.
So they need follow-up?
Yeah.
But of course, like Prashant said, if it's causing renal failure, and if you can prove that by biopsy, then you've got a case for treatment.
So for this case, we need to keep amyloidosis in the mind. That was the message. So 22-year-old female diagnosed with referred as a case of ITP for further.
Twenty-six-year-old female, 3 months of amenorrhea and bleedings, ecchymotic patch, and hematuria. There was a severe thrombocytopenia. So what will be differentials? Pregnant lady with thrombocytopenia. First differential, yeah. And little later, yeah. Sir, any comment?
See, at any stage of pregnancy, if the platelet count is less than 1 lakh, you need to look for other causes other than gestational thrombocytopenia. So that is number one. Gestational thrombocytopenia usually comes in a late pregnancy. And somebody who has 6,000 platelet at any point of pregnancy as such is definitely not physiological. It has to be pathological. Something has to be evaluated. Only thing is that 3 months amenorrhea, sometimes it becomes difficult to go and do a bone marrow on these people. You know, tomorrow something happens that will be blamed on the bone marrow that you have done. You know, whatever may be the outcome of the pregnancy. So you have to be a bit cautious. You have to rely more on other excluding criteria like as he has written, PTA, PTT has to be normal. The peripheral smear, you look, is there anything else there? That's what you need to see. And this is extremely important, past history. In these patients, always, this is primigravida, you told?
Yes, sir,
primigravida. Primigravida, at least you don't have the previous history of childbirth. If somebody has a history of previous childbirth, what was there at that point of time, that pregnancy, that becomes extremely important. The other thing that is more important is, 25-year-old lady, definitely, at least her parents will remember when she was a child, the fall of primary teeth, you know. Was there excess bleed during removal of the primary teeth? That becomes a crucial history for you people because that suggests there is some congenital issue that is going on. If there is, and menarche. At the time of menarche, was there a menorrhagia? You know, upfront menorrhagia. If there was, then again, you have to think of some congenital issues presenting there. If absolutely there is no other history, then you can think of ITP and these things.
Yeah, pregnancy is one of the differential diagnoses for TTP. Pregnancy itself can cause thrombocytopenia in TTP, purpura. But in this case, anyway, it was ITP only. We did bone marrow because the family was well-to-do and there were many doctors involved in the family happened to do bone marrow. This is the later part of a pregnancy, referred for asymptomatic thrombocytopenia. The platelet count were above 50,000. They're not in the range of severe. So in this case, we need to think of a gestational thrombocytopenia. Cause of pregnancy in thrombocytopenia, the differentials. Coming to the last case, the lymphedema.
This again, that 54,000 may not be a gestational thrombocytopenia. It may be ITP, a simple ITP there. Because gestational thrombocytopenia, generally the guidelines as of 2019, the ASH guidelines state that anything platelet less more than 1 lakh, then only it is most possibly gestational thrombocytopenia. They have given the clear-cut guidelines on that. And any platelet count less than 60,000, they tell clearly no gestational thrombocytopenia. It may be a mild ITP there. We don't have
chronic
to do
ITP,
anything.
Yeah.
Most important thing, her platelet count is more than 50,000. That is more than enough to carry her pregnancy to the term and normally deliver. So we don't have to intervene at this point of time for this patient at all.
So, what was the pregnancy like for that patient? Did she have a normal, uneventful delivery?
I mean, just like recently I've seen, we need to go across this.
So this kind of patient, you have to
you know, if she is crossed 30 weeks of pregnancy, possibly once in 2 weeks, do the platelet count, keep under follow-up, and, you know, plan for an institutional delivery, and at least admit the patient 4 to 5 days before the expected due date as such, because you can't have that patient, you know, suddenly coming to you with 30,000 platelet count and with the labor pain, you know, then everybody will be panicking. So these are the cases which has to be elective institutionalized deliveries.
Do we need to rule out SLE in such settings? Young female with
thrombocytopenia? Yes. And again, later on, you know, sometimes you have patients with eclampsia, preeclampsia, you know, fatty liver of pregnancy, all these things are differential. But you need to sort of, you know, make a clear-cut evaluation and monitor this patient. Ideally, you know, in some countries they have got this, what is called the joint heme obstetric clinic. But here again, you know, this is something to be closely monitored between the hematologist and obstetrician to prevent surprises. But in spite of all that, sometimes you do have patients going into labor with platelet count of 30. And then you may have to manage that. I think here the indications are not based on the platelet count. It will be the obstetric indications.
In any of the hematological disorders per se, the delivery is always. Mode of delivery is always obstetrical indication. The hematological parameters never dictate the mode of delivery. So that is very clear. If the platelet count is 30,000 or 50,000, if the patient can undergo a normal delivery, it has to be normal delivery. There is no indication for a cesarean. The same with the von Willebrand deficiency or factor 13 deficiency, whatever may be the case.
I just want to add one more condition. The pregnant ladies with thrombocytopenia, we must rule out extrahepatic EHPV. Extrahepatic portal vein obstruction. Because those ladies usually have an uneventful pregnancy course. They conceive, they deliver, and it could be one of the benefits. So liver should be sorted out. Liver and extrahepatic portal vein obstruction.
One comment about the delivery is that, you know, for both vaginal delivery and C-section, both the cutoff. We would like to keep this platelet count of 50,000. But only thing is at 50,000 you can't have epidural. That is the only difference there. So, whether you need to have a delivery earlier to save the mother's life or fetal life, that is a decision by the obstetrician. We won't interfere in that.
As I told, EHPV is something very, very common in our belt. Actually, just last week I had a patient of EHPV who was delivered in UCT hospital. You know, it's extremely common. Lot of the times what happens, you know, scanning madidare. Yenta scanning madidare, they have done only obstetric scan. Patient with the thrombocytopenia always insist on a full ultrasound abdomen. That is compulsory. For any thrombocytopenia with pregnancy, ultrasound full abdomen should be there because they will be looking absolutely normal, but you will see portal hypertension. Dilated portal veins and a splenomegaly once you do the ultrasound. That's what sir told is absolutely right.
Another marker is that thrombocytopenia can itself mean a predictor for the varices. So although those patients do not conceive, but thrombocytopenia should alert in a non-pregnant lady about the, now NASH is coming in a big way, so about the development of the varices and splenomegaly. Is there a non-invasive biomarker?
We proceed for the next. 52-year male working as a housekeeping in a railway department, railway station. He doesn't have comorbid illness. Recently, his father died of a pulmonary tuberculosis. His father was working in a railway housekeeping. He presented with a neck swelling, low grade fever, loss of appetite, and there was no weight loss.
It was only swelling and fever. Is evaluated outside. Where hemoglobin was 11, mild anemia, WBC and platelets were in range, ESR was high, and MON2 was positive. His chest X-ray was looking normal. He underwent FNAC of neck lymph nodes, which showed a caseation-like material, but AFB strain was negative. He received an antituberculo for 2 months, and then found no improvement, and happened to present to us. So, lymphoma should be kept in the mind.
I agree that
sarcoidosis is.
I agree that anti-tuberculous therapy was given, but again, all the wide differentials of lymphadenopathy, including lymphoma and sarcoidosis. So, what would be the next investigation? Now, are you happy with that investigation, the FNA of the node?
Yeah, that was the question. That was the question supposed to be asked.
So that is the question.
Correct.
Yes. Question mark. So is it efficacious or not? That's what you need to think of.
So the question is, main discussion on this case will be FNAC as a tool for an evaluation of a lymphadenopathy. That was the question.
Yeah.
So are you happy with the FNA? That is the question. So is that enough? Should you have done that?
If the FNAC shows AFB, then there may be a case for you to stop at that level. If the FNAC doesn't show AFB, or if the gene expert on FNAC done is negative, then you cannot stop there. Always go for excisional biopsy. There is no other option there. You have to go. We have seen combination of TB and lymphoma in the same lymph node.
Yeah.
In the same lymph node, both the lesions are present. It can happen. It is described in the literature from India only.
Yeah, that was a question. FNAC as a tool, and further, ideally further scanning need to be done to look for other lymph nodes also. The biopsy was suggestive of a Hodgkin lymphoma. Immunohistochemistry was CHL. We did a TBNAT on the sample, which was showing mycobacterium based on the gene expert. So he had both, as we discussed. He had a tuberculosis with lymphoma. Yeah.
This is well-known coexistence of.
And Hodgkin mimics like tuberculosis, but the mimicker of tuberculosis that we call it as in during our first year of hematology training. We get to discuss like a case presentation, like mimickers of tuberculosis in lymphoma. I mean, comment for the panel members, the outcome of Hodgkin present day, Hodgkin lymphoma treatment and the outcomes.
I think you got fantastic treatment for Hodgkin lymphoma these days with more than 80 to 90% survival. So the main thing you would risk assess to see, what is the stage. So you need to stage the disease and type of Hodgkin, and then essentially for Hodgkin lymphoma, you would organize a PET scan, a baseline PET scan. So this is because the survival is so good that you want to decide whether you want to reduce the intensity of treatment after two cycles of treatment. So if you think the disease has responded really well to treatment, your repeat PET scan would show a good response, and then you may decide on cutting down one of the medicines. Or if the response is suboptimal, you may decide on increasing the treatment to something more stronger, like PECOP. So this is one of the indications for PET scan. And again, these days you got good treatment. So it would be a pity if and you got second line treatments as well with antibody based treatments and you got nivolumab, which is a newer drug as well.
In Hodgkin's lymphoma, remember there are, if you have a 10 centimeter node, only 2% of that cells inside that lymph node are malignant. 98% of the cells are reactive lymphocytes. So that is why if you do a FNA, invariably they will tell reactive lymphadenopathy, that's all. So that is why you have to go for an excision biopsy to rule out a Hodgkin's lymphoma. I think, Mahadev, it was a very good case series that you have presented. Fantastic. Thank you.
I think totally agree. Excellent case series. Interestingly,
in fact, today my niece's child's naming ceremony, and I was supposed to talk there, but I am here. It doesn't matter, but I think today's program went so well. There are a lot of things which probably we have learned, and I find hematology is rather difficult subject. I thought peripheral smear was a very simple thing. Iron deficiency was good. Megaloblastic was good. But I never thought that there are so many intricate things one has to learn. All the best for the newer postgraduates who have to go a long way before they complete their things. And it was a, you know, I am very happy that we had fantastic resource persons who made us life very easy and very innovative and very, very, you know, enjoyable. Thank all the four people who have come and participated in the CME. Thank you very much.
Yeah, they will tell during the bus around. Okay. So we have four teams. Team A, please introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Ram Mohan from KSECD, Medical Academy, from the Department of General Medicine.
I'm Dr. Ruhi from Department of General Medicine, KSECD.
Team B.
I'm Dr. Rekha from AJ Institute of Medical Sciences, Medicine.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Swati S. from AJMS, Department of Medicine.
I'm Dr. Priya from Yenepoya Medical College, Department of Pathology.
I'm Dr. Sneha from Yenepoya Medical College, Department of Pathology.
I'm Dr. Somaya, Department of Pathology.
I'm Dr. Smera, Department of Pathology, Yenepoya Medical College.
So we'll move to the quiz directly. So these are the general rules. So quiz is for 1 hour, and there will be four rounds. And the audience, please be quiet during the rounds. You will get your chance. After they cannot answer, I will pass on to the audience. Those who want to answer can raise their hands, and they will get their prizes. Okay? Okay. So we'll move on to the first round. So these are the rounds. I will tell the rules of the each round as and when the round progresses. Okay. We move on to the first round. Please, these are the rules of the round. So each team will get a direct question. Each team has 30 seconds to answer that direct question. If they cannot answer within the 30 seconds, it will be passed on to the next team, who will get 10 seconds to answer the past question. If the team answers the direct question correctly, they will get 30 marks. If the team answers the past question, they will get 15 marks. There is no negative marking. If nobody could answer, it will go on to the audience who can answer the question. Okay, correct? Everybody is clear with the rules? So team B, team A, you have your first question in round number one. Round. So team A, you are ready? Okay. So a 43-year-old man comes to the hospital due to recurrent episodes of fever and sore throat despite multiple courses of antibiotic therapy. For the past several months, he has also felt run down and fatigued all the time. His wife adds that he has bruises easily and he has bleeding gums on several occasions. His temperature is 100.2 degree Fahrenheit. On examination, he has mucosal pallor, pharyngeal erythema, and multiple ecchymotic patches. His peripheral picture is shown here. So what is the likely diagnosis? Your time starts now.
CML?
Sure.
AML.
You have to be specific.
APML.
Okay, that's the right answer. This is AML M3 variant, APML. You can see this. These are the promyelocytes with oroids inside. Okay, so team A gets 30 marks. Okay, next question. Say they. Okay. Okay, they have to answer once only. Okay. Yeah. Okay, next question. So this is a question for the next team, team B. So you have a 69-year-old man who comes to the physician because of a 2-month history of weight loss, fatigue, and night sweats. He has lost approximately 6.8 kilograms. Physical examination shows multiple painless palpable cervical and axillary lymph nodes. His spleen is palpable 3 centimeters below costal margin. Lab shows a leukocyte count of 27,000, hemoglobin of 10.8, and MCV of 80. This is a peripheral smear. What is your likely diagnosis? Only one answer. Whatever you answer first will be considered as the answer.
CLL.
Okay. This is CLL. Correct answer. These are the cells. These are the smudge cells. Okay. This is CLL. Correct answer. Team B gets 30 points. So team C. So this is your direct question. A 72-year-old man comes to the physician because of fatigue and easy bruising. Physical examination shows hepatosplenomegaly. The lab value shows TLC of 4,000, erythrocyte count of 3.8 million, blood hemoglobin level of 9.6 grams, and platelet of 1,20,000. Abnormal appearing lymphocytes are seen in the peripheral smear. What is your likely diagnosis?
Hairy cell leukemia.
Sure? Yeah, the answer is correct. This is hairy cell leukemia. Can you say what is this stain used? Okay. Correct. Yes. They have a definite advantage over here. Okay. So the last question to group team D. So a 6-year-old boy is brought to the office for fatigue and abdominal distension. His parents also say that the patient's bruises easily and appears pale. Physical examination reveals subconjunctival pallor and several ecchymosis on the boy's extremities. His abdomen is distended with non-tender massive splenomegaly and moderate hepatomegaly. The lab shows hemoglobin of 8, leukocyte count of 3,800 and platelet of 90,000. This is the bone marrow. What is your diagnosis? Team D. No. Passed on to group A. Team A. Passed on to group team B.
PMF.
Wrong. Yeah. This is right answer. This is the bone marrow. These are the, crumpled tissue paper appearance. Okay. 15 marks to team C. Okay. We are done with the first round. So can we have the scores, please?
Team C is in the lead with 45 points at the end of round one.
Okay. So we move on to the next round, which is round two. So round two is a category round. So we have 6 categories. And the team with the least point will get to choose first. And if they answer the question, they get 30 marks. They cannot pass the question. There is no passing. There is no negative marking. And they get 30 seconds for each question. OK? So the first question will go to team D. These are the categories. You can choose one category out of each. Okay, they chose hematopathology. Can we have the question? So, this is your question. What is the mutation seen in mantle cell lymphoma? No? Pathology PGs? Okay. So we'll pass that question to the audience. Anybody want to answer can raise their hands. They will get prizes. Anybody want to answer has to raise their hands. Yeah. Give. Yeah, stand up and answer. Wrong. Please be seated. Anybody want to answer? Nobody? Yeah, correct answer. 1114. He is from Sullia Medical College doing his MD then. Okay, give a round of applause for him. Okay. So two teams are tied, A and B. So we will go serially. Team A gets a chance to choose next.
We choose hemato-oncology.
They have chosen hemato-oncology. Can we have the question, please? Okay, this is your question. Which drug is the only cytoreductive agent proven to reduce thrombotic events in polycythemia vera? Which drug is the only cytoreductive agent proven to reduce thrombotic events in polycythemia vera? Team A. There is no passing of questions. Yeah, now time up. It's passed on to the audience. I saw so many. So I am the quiz master. I go to decide. I saw hands from there first. Yeah. Humira can answer. Yeah, that's the correct answer. That's the discretion of the quiz master. Okay. Okay. Not biased. I saw it first. That's it. Okay. So, can we have, you can choose, team B can choose next. One second, we'll have the categories. Yes. So, they have chosen general hematology. Can we have the question, please? Yes, this is your question. C3 convertase in classical pathway of complement system is? C3 convertase in classical pathway of complement system is?
C1, C2, C4.
Wrong answer. It will be passed on to the audience. Yes. Vijay? C4B, 3, 2. Sorry, wrong answer. Anybody else? Please raise your hands. Please raise your hands if you want to answer, please. Please raise your hands if you want to answer. No negative marking, you will get chocolates if you get the answer.
Ashrit sir. Ashrit sir.
Yeah, third years, third years. Anybody can answer.
Ashrit sir is raising.
Yeah, yeah, Ashrit. Yeah, C4B, 2B. That's the right answer. Initially, it was C4B, 2A. Now it is C4B, 2B. Okay, right answer. He's updated also. Okay. Okay. So, now it's the chance for Team C.
Blood transfusion.
Okay. Can we have the question, please? Blood transfusion. Simple question.
24 degrees.
We'll. Okay, that's the right answer. 22 plus or minus 2. Okay, they get their 30 points. So, we have done with the second round. Can we have the.
At the end of round two, Team B is yet to open the account. Team D is yet to open the account. Team A and Team B are tied at 30 points, and Team C is in the lead at 75 points.
You want the other two questions also? Yeah, we'll open that. So this is only for the audience, okay? So, hemostasis and thrombosis. Yeah. Which direct thrombin inhibitor is used for the treatment of HIT, which is synthesized from arginine? Yeah, Saeed? Synthesized from arginine, wrong answer. Yeah, lepiridine is used, but the question is specific. Synthesized from arginine. Only one chance. No, that is yet to be approved for Fonda used in HIT. Yeah, answer is right. It's ergotropin. So Bharatesh get a chocolate. So can we have the next question? So bone marrow transplantation. What is the agent used to cryopreserve stem cells? What is the agent used to cryopreserve stem cells? Yeah, no. Only one chance. Anybody else? Okay, if nobody is there, yeah, Vijay has asked. If nobody is there, Shamna. Yeah. Sorry, no. Shamna. Yeah, sir. Yes, sir. Sir is correct. He gets the chocolate. It's dimethyl sulfoxide. Okay. So we are done with the second round. Now we move on to the third round. It will be a buzzer round. We'll be displaying a visual. And those who presses the buzzer first, that they will be deciding who presses the, that's up to them. Those who presses the buzzer first will be the principal team. They can answer the question, and we will be giving the other teams a chance. So they will be the challenging team. After the principal team answers, the other teams has a chance to press the buzzer after they have answered. That is the challenging team. If the principal team answers it correctly, you get 50 points. And if you answer wrongly, you 20 marks is deducted from your account. Okay? And if the challenging team is right, they get 30 marks. If they doesn't correct, it's a wrong answer, 15 marks will be deducted. Understood? Everybody is clear? There is a principal team. Principal team is decided based on pressing the buzzer. Whoever presses the buzzer will be the principal team. They have to answer first. After that, any other team can press the buzzer. They will be the challenging team. If that answer is correct and your answer is wrong, there will be negative marking for each team. Okay? Okay? Everybody is clear?
Sir, we would like to have a score of after round two, total score.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, that already told. Okay. Official round. Fingers already. Okay. Can you have the visual, please? Yes. What is the name attributed to the cutaneous manifestation of this disease? What is the name attributed to the cutaneous manifestation of this disease? Not the disease, cutaneous manifestation of the disease. Yeah, done. Nobody want to answer? It will be passed on to the audience. Yeah, this is Darius sign. And the disease is? Yeah, systemic mastocytosis. So that red lesion which you are seeing is the Darius sign. Mast cells got scratched, and if they scratch, they will get a localized erythema purpural articular-like lesion. That is the Darius sign, and the disease is systemic mastocytosis. Okay? Okay. Yeah, next. Yes. Give the diagnosis. What is the disease? Smear is on the right side. The nail sign is there on the left. Right side. No. Everybody is playing cautiously. At least Team D should be pressing the buzzer. You have nothing to lose. Okay. Okay, done. Now, the audience, please raise your hands. No, wrong answer. Anybody else? Yeah, this is cryoglobulinemia. And this is, what is that nail sign? What is a nail sign? How go to the diagnosis then? Okay, the nail sign is subungual purpura. And that peripheral smear is showing cryoglobulins. Okay. Okay, Kishan gets a chocolate. Okay. Yeah, next visual. What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? Time up. Okay, passed on to the audience. Please raise your hands if you want to answer. Yeah. They are not answering, sir. Yeah. Yeah. Answer? No. Sir, this is Sézary syndrome. So this is a cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. Okay? Sézary syndrome. Okay. Wait. So, next question. Yes. What is the diagnosis? Yes, team D is the principal team, and team B is the challenging team. No, she pressed fix up. You are now challenging team. If the answer is correctly, your mark will be deducted. Okay. Okay. After they answer, if they press again, if anybody want to press again, they will be the challenging team. Okay. You can answer. Team D. Yes. This is thalassemia. This is a chipmunk face and the hair on her appearance only. Okay. Thalassemia. Group D gets 50 marks. Okay. Yeah. Okay. They have opened their account grandly. Okay.
So at the end of round three, the whole thing changed with the last question. Team A and Team B are at third position jointly at 30 points. Team D has gone up to 50 marks and Team C at 75. So both the pathology teams are fighting it out right now.
Okay. So next. This is the last round. This is a rapid fire. Each team gets 45 seconds to answer the question. Each team gets a maximum of 6 questions. They can pass the question in between if they don't want to answer it. They can come back to the question later on if the time permits. Okay, each answer, correct answer will get 20 marks. If they get all the answers correct, they get a bonus mark of 30 points. Okay? So there is no negative marking. Okay? So we will go serially. Team A, are you ready? Timer ready? Okay. So your time starts now. So coagulation factor deficient in stored blood is? If you don't know answer, pass the question. Cast iron spleen is found in? Splenectomy is virtually curative in hereditary spherocytosis. True or false? Wrong. Which clotting factor is called the clot stabilizing factor? Yeah, correct answer. Direct thrombin inhibitor used in heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is? Sorry. Name the monoclonal antibody against CD38 used to treat myeloma. Pass or next? No. Wrong. Eczema thrombocytopenia immunodeficiency syndrome is also known as? Time up. Okay. Okay. They have one correct answer. Okay. So, audience? Coagulation factor deficient in stored blood is? No, factor 5. Okay. Yeah. Cast iron spleen is found in? CML, correct. Splenectomy is virtually curative in hereditary spherocytosis? It's a true statement. Which clotting factor is called clot stabilizing factor? 13. Factor 13. Monoclonal antibody against CD38? No, daratumumab. Okay. Eczema thrombocytopenia immunodeficiency syndrome is called? Viscoalter syndrome. Okay. So team A gets 20 points from rapid fire. So team B, your time starts now. Half life of platelet is?
5 days.
Yeah, correct. Cooley's anemia is?
Beta thalassemia.
Correct. Shum test is done to detect?
Pass.
Cytogenetics is the single most important test in determining prognosis of AML patient. True or false?
True.
Correct. Drug of choice for acute promyelocytic leukemia is?
Atra.
Correct. Direct CUM test positive autoimmune hemolytic anemia with ITP is called?
I heard it.
Okay, pass. They are very okay. They didn't answer it even if they heard.
Heemal syndrome.
Okay, they heard it. They saw. They told. Okay. So can we have the score? They have 4 correct answers. They have 80 points. Yeah, good. Okay. Okay. Team C, ready? Their time starts now. Iron transport protein is called?
Ferroprotein.
Wrong. Ham's test is positive in? Gene mutation seen in congenital TTPs?
ADMT.
Yeah, correct. PET scoring evaluate the possibility of metastatic disease by demonstrating tyrosine kinase activity?
True.
False. Second most common malignancy associated with HIV is? Second most common malignancy associated with HIV is? Wrong. Hereditary pseudohemophilia is? Don't know. Okay. Audience?
Time up.
Transport protein is transferring. Okay. Ham test is positive in? Wrong. PNH, yes. PET scoring evaluate possibility of metastatic disease by? It's actually glucose uptake. Okay, correct. Second most common malignancy associated with HIV is? NHL. First is Kaposi, second is NHL. Hereditary pseudohemophilia is? It's von Willebrand disease, type 3. Okay? The association of post-cricoid dysphagia, upper esophageal web, and iron deficiency anemia is called? Wrong. Basophilic stippling is seen in? No, wrong. Mutation seen in polycythemia rubra vera? Over, next. Mutation seen in polycythemia rubra vera? Yeah, correct. Prothrombin complex concentrate is used in emergency reversal of anticoagulants in patients with severe bleeding. Okay. Name the oral thrombopoietin receptor agonist used in ITP. Pass our next question. Yeah. Last question. Profound thrombocytopenia related to platelet trapping within a vascular tumor is called? Time up. Okay. So, first question, one correct answer. Mutation of polycythemia rubra vera. 20. Yeah, first is Plummer-Wilson. Basophilic stippling, as you told, it is lead poisoning. Mutation is JAK-STAT, correct. Prothrombin, that is a correct statement, true. Oral thrombopoietin, L-thrombopag, you have newer two agents also. And profound thrombocytopenia is Kesebach-Merritt syndrome. Okay. So we are done with the rounds. Can we have the final scores, please? Yeah. So team A, the final score is 50. It's okay, give a round of applause for them. Team D is with 70 points. Team C is the runner-up. They get 95 points. And the winners are Team B. They get 110 points total. Yeah,
okay. Give me a chocolate. I don't think anybody has done a better job than this person. You know, he must have worked really hard. Thank you very much. It was nice.
Before the prize distribution, we actually wanted to give the
they were my backbone. I didn't tell them anything. I just told three of them.
Dr. Swati and Dr. Rekha.
He is a quiz master in AJ. Sasya, smile. Oh, smile. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, man.